All right, this is part four on globalization and place. I think in the previous parts, I've thrown a lot of content at you. Admittedly, there is a lot of content today. There are lots of different theories, lots of different theorists, many different conflicting ideas as well, doing different things. If there's anything today that you're not comfortable with, or you feel like the explanation is just not where it needs to be, please have a look at the textbook. Everything I'm talking about today is repeated in the textbook as well. The textbook has the glossary and also lots of online resources as well. And also just feel free to ask your tutor. If you're not sure about particular aspects of these theories or ideas, ask your tutor, email me. We really want to help you out and help you understand all the things that are going on here. Sociologists have lots of different ideas about globalization. There's lots of conflicting views, and it can be difficult to really get a hang of some of the ideas that are being discussed. What I wanted to do in this part is maybe move down from the realm of abstract theory and just think a little bit more about the political context in which sociologists are operating today and in which their studies are going to be operating as well. Because what we're seeing in many cases is really a reassertion of the concept of place against globalizing forces. And many new social movements are arising to push back against globalization. And I think it's important to think about where those movements are coming from and how we might think about or understand them as sociologists. When we think about sociology, particularly in the 90s, I've talked about Ulrich Beck and the idea of one global society. I've talked about Francis Fukuyama and the idea of the end of history. You see, there's a lot of enthusiasm or a lot of optimism, perhaps. Certainly a strong sense that globalization is this inevitable process that's marching on, that's going to take over the whole world, that we'll all be living in these big regional unions under globalized forms of governance. Now, that prediction or that optimism of many sociologists in the 90s did not really pan out. And instead, what we've seen is a very strong reassertion of the idea of nation and the idea of place. And it's something I want to work through here and think about some of those contemporary social movements that are arising against globalization, or we could be thinking about the backlash against globalization. What I've said here is that globalization should never be thought of as automatic or inevitable. It is a result of economic, social, and political forces, right? In many ways, it's something that has been chosen by populations or political leaders. They've decided to pursue the path of globalization. And now many people would like to pursue the opposite path, and I think it's important to think about why. So globalization is really emerging today as a key point of political debate. I think in recent years it's become a point of special significance as well. The fate of many political movements and politicians really rests today on the opinions they have on many of these globalization-related trends. So I think to study globalization is also to understand some of the political trends that are going on in contemporary societies. We've seen many movements that are championing the return to the nation. So movements for national identity, movements against regional unions like the European Union. We've seen breakaway movements, independence referendums, things like this. At the same time, it's not just a climate of anti-globalization. There are significant social movements today which have emerged to reassert the importance of cosmopolitan and international values. And there are many politicians which have placed their flag in the sand for more internationalist values. So again, I think it's important to understand this kind of context and to try and think about where these different sentiments have come from. I'm going to focus on anti-globalization movements because they've really dominated the discussion, particularly over the past decade or so. And I want to think about some of the key causes of anti-globalization movements. The key one would probably be that there have been structural losers from the globalization process. So there have been structural transformations associated with economic globalization, which have left many people worse off. So there are concerns that globalization might be contributing to rising inequality. In many cases, there are people in certain industries where those industries have been decimated by the process of globalization. We often say when talking about economic globalization in particular that the benefits are very diffuse and the negatives are very concentrated. So in terms of something like free trade, everyone tends to benefit from free trade in the form of slightly lower prices for goods. But the people who lose out from free trade, say in certain industries, are hit very hard by those things. So the political question is how to balance these very diffuse benefits with these very strong costs. And for those who have faced very strong costs, this has driven a lot of anti-globalization sentiments. And we do have data on this. So I had some data here that indicated that regions which face higher trade competition with countries like China tend to show much higher support for protectionism and higher support, particularly for right-wing parties. We also find that far-right anti-globalization parties tend to have higher political success in times of higher financial instability. And that could be some interesting data to think about as well. What are some other things which have driven anti-globalization sentiment? Well, there is a growing perception of global hazards. I think Ulrich Beck is quite important to talk about here. So Beck's idea that we live in this global risk society, that the globalized news media is increasingly showing us the kind of risks we face from global interconnectedness, this has led many to question the merits of interconnectedness. So what you might find is that I think especially the impact of COVID has led many people to feel like maybe we are too interconnected as societies, and perhaps we want to have, say, more localized production, more local supply chains to protect us from the influence of these, it might be global pandemics, it might be global financial shocks, anything like that. The third point is about the increase of immigration. So movements against cultural globalization in particular have often centered on movements against immigration, or often movements against immigration have been a key part of these kinds of movements. You can't talk about that without thinking about the immense increase of immigration that's occurred after the 1960s. So immigration has always been a part of globalization, the mass movement of people around the world, but really the mass movement of people into the global north has accelerated since the 1960s with periods of being up or down. And I think this has driven a range of concerns about national identity and culture in these countries. In many cases, there's been a very strong, virulent, violent pushback against cultural globalization because of these anxieties associated with cultural change arising from immigration. We can also think about the emergence of some major international institutions post-World War II. And I think this has led many to be concerned with diminishing national sovereignty. We could think about the United Nations. We could think about the emergence of institutions like the European Union. And I think also today there appears to be concern about the growing influence of simply large non-governmental organizations. Certain private sector organizations as well, but also perhaps people are concerned about the influence of many of these kind of powerful non-governmental organizations or activist organizations as well. Let's break down some of these movements and try to think about them in more detail. So I want to think about movements against economic, political, and cultural globalization. So movements against economic globalization are typically protectionist in nature. That is, they want regulation to protect local economies against the influence of international financial trends. Typically, this means opposition to free trade deals, criticism of institutions like the World Trade Organization or the IMF that seek to create free trade around the world, and very strong opposition to the influence of big multinational corporations. Typically, the main idea behind movements against economic globalization is a belief that economic globalization has worsened the economic conditions of workers. Okay, so movements of this kind often arise from the working class, and they can take very populist forms. They can be found on the anti-capitalist left, but also on this emerging alt-right constellation. So if you think of, say, the election of Donald Trump as a politician was not your typical free trade type Republican politician. He was, in fact, he expressed strong opposition to many of the trade deals evident at the time, and I think that protectionist stance was quite appealing to certain members of the working class. At the same time that Trump was being elected, you see on the opposite side of the political spectrum candidates like Bernie Sanders pushing the same narrative that things like the TPP, free trade deals like that, were going to be harmful to workers and should be opposed. And I did find some data that indicated, I have it here, that support for economic protectionism is stronger among those people concerned about the environment, consumer health, and labor conditions abroad. So I think it's interesting to see how movements against economic globalization have emerged on both the left and the right. And it's really only the center that is continuing this stance that is pro economic globalization. And it's interesting to think about these new coalitions that are forming politically, why they might be forming and what they might have in common in various regards, but of course also what they might disagree on too. We can also think about movements against political globalization. So these are movements which support political isolationism. A classic example would be something like Brexit, where you have this concern that supranational institutions, so institutions above the level of the state, whether these are regional unions or international bodies like the United Nations, treaty organizations like NATO, this increasing sense that these are dominating the nation state, that the nation state needs to reassert itself against these kinds of trends. Again, thinking about the election of Donald Trump, who was not particularly pro-NATO, thinking about the Leave movement in the UK and this idea of leaving the European Union because it was encroaching upon national sovereignty, or so the campaigners would argue. You do see some movements like this on the political left as well. Certainly criticisms of bodies like NATO have been, you see down the bottom I have a protest from Venezuela. There have been some criticisms of these big treaty organizations, some opposition to things like the United Nations. And there has historically been some left-wing sentiment against institutions like the United Nations because they are essentially free trade bodies, and free trade zones are created from bodies like this. So I think it's, again, interesting to think about how these coalitions have formed against globalization, both political and economic, that come from all sides of the political spectrum. Typically, these movements are not trying to reassert state authority just for the sake of it, but often they have a strong belief against things like economic or cultural globalization. So a lot of the movement to leave the European Union would have been driven by economic anxiety caused by economic globalization. The idea is we want to reassert the power of the state so we can prevent, say, political or cultural globalization, maybe prevent immigrants of different cultures coming into a country, maybe protect local industry, something like that. Lastly, there are various movements against cultural globalization as well, and obviously all these movements are often tied in together, but they do take different forms depending on the kind of globalization they might be concentrating on. So movements against cultural globalization typically involve what I would say nationalism or nativism, a strong appeal to the idea of the nation or to the idea of a particular ethnic, national or religious identity, and often a belief that this religious or national identity is under threat from the process of cultural globalization. On the political right, this would often take the form of, say, very strong movements against immigration, a very strong anti-immigrant sentiment, a rejection of the idea of multiculturalism, and the belief that, say, we should enforce certain cultural ideas on the population. You can see as an example here, I have protests against Islam in Australia. So here are individuals seeing Islamic culture as a threat to Australian culture and trying to fight against that in their movement. In their most extreme forms, these movements can often take the form of, again, strong political violence, strong racist sentiments. You can think of something like fascist Germany as being the quintessential example of an anti-cultural globalization nationalist movement. There was a strong belief in amongst the fascist leaders of Nazi Germany that we needed to reassert, or the Germans needed to reassert, a very strong idea of German national culture against this encroaching liberal European values. Okay, so in its most pernicious forms, this cultural globalization can become justification for some of the very strong forms of nationalism we saw in World War II and even beyond. There are forms of anti-cultural globalization, which I would say are evident on the political left as well. These are typically movements against what is called cultural imperialism. So one key part of colonization was the spreading of the culture of the colonizer onto the colonized. You can think of colonial India as a classic example, where there was an attempt to devalue local Indian customs and religions, an attempt to supplant them with Christianity, an attempt to supplant local language with English, forms of dress, traditional forms of dress were supplanted by traditional English clothing. And so many of the anti-colonial movements post-World War II were actually based upon strong nationalistic ideas of, say, returning to a local culture against this sense of an encroaching cultural imperialism coming from the West. I think you also see this idea still in many contemporary indigenous movements today, this idea that there has been a domination of indigenous culture by the culture of the colonizer, and there needs to be a pushback against that. You might think about the campaigns to, you know, go back to indigenous place names, for instance. So talking about Uluru rather than Ayers Rock would be a good example. You know, Ayers Rock being an example of cultural imperialism here, where something has a local indigenous place name and it is overrun by a dominant culture, which is then supplants the local culture. And many indigenous movements are involved in this sense of trying to revalue indigenous culture, to reassert the importance of indigenous culture, and to kind of almost rescue indigenous culture from its destruction by the process of colonization. Okay, so I would see all these movements as movements against cultural globalization, in that there is a spreading of ideas around the world, either by violence, by immigration, by force, whatever, but there is an attempt by a local culture to push back against those processes. Obviously, we can't equate these kind of movements in any kind of moral way, and I think it's worth thinking about why we see these movements in different ways. You know, why movements for Indigenous pride might be different to this Aussie pride individual in the top photograph in the slide here. There are obviously various historical, political, social factors that make us react to these movements differently, consider these movements differently, and give them very different moral and political standing. Nonetheless, I think you can analyze them all using the ideas of cultural globalization, because in many ways they are more localist, the attempt of a more localist culture to assert itself against what it sees as dominant and corrosive forces coming from other parts of the world. You might ask, with all these movements going on, where does the general public stand on some of these issues? And I actually found this interesting data that I wanted to talk through with you. So this is data from 15 countries around the world, some countries from the global north, some from the global south. And what you see here is that people's views on economic, political, and cultural globalization are often very contradictory and very confused. That is, people will hold very contradictory positions. So here's an example. If you look at the economic part of this, so people are asked a question, and the questions are: free trade means better products, international companies damage local business, and my country should limit imports. What you see, if you actually chart this on the graph here, is that basically everyone agrees with all of these questions, even though these questions imply contradictory things. So if you look at the blue bar, free trade means better products, well, most people agree. International companies damage local business, most people agree. Countries should limit imports, most people agree. So what do you do with that? It seems that most people are both anti and pro economic globalization at the same time. And I think it gives you that sense that these are very complicated and messy topics. And people really like some aspects of economic globalization, but not others. The question is whether you can have one without the other. Perhaps not. If you look at political globalization, the questions are about international organizations. So here we see strong agreement in the blue bar that international organizations should have the right to enforce solutions on countries. But also the green bar, international organizations take too much power from government. There's a bit less agreement, but still in the agreement. There's not disagreement over those kinds of issues. So again, I would see a bit of a contradiction here, that at the same time people think, oh, we should give more power to international organizations. Yet, on the opposite, people think that these organizations take too much power from their governments. In the cultural category, same kind of thing. You see mixed opinion. Most people in the middle on all of these topics. So more national content should be shown on television. Most people seem to be slightly agreeing on that. Immigrants take jobs from natives, again, slight agreement, and immigrants bring new ideas, again, slight agreement. So what you see here, as I said, very complicated, very contradictory views in the public. Very divided views, I would say, but also lots of messiness in the way that people think about these different types of topics. And that probably gives room for globalization to become a key topic of political debate, because different sides, pro, anti-globalization, on the political left and the political right, can appeal to some of these different contradictory elements in the individual and lead the conversation in various ways. What I think is interesting is that views have not really shifted much during the time this data was collected. So this is from 1995 to 2013. If we look at economic globalization, views really haven't changed at all. Same thing with cultural globalization. Okay, so views have been very stable during this period. What I would love to see is more updated data, particularly around 2016, you know, the Trump election, the Brexit campaign, and particularly now that, you know, 2020, COVID, all these different things. What I would like you to think about going into the tutorials is, how would you answer those questions, and why? That's probably something you might want to think about, and think about, have your views on these topics changed over time? And do you yourself hold contradictory views about the benefits and drawbacks of globalization? Where would you stand on some of these issues? It is tricky, and it is difficult to pin down some of the benefits and the drawbacks. All right, that's all I had for you today. Let me give you a brief conclusion. I've said that sociologists understand globalization to be integrated shifts in economic, political, and cultural spheres. It is really important that you see globalization as being this three-pronged thing. It's not just one of these. It's not all of them together. One can increase without the other increasing at the same time. One can be opposed to cultural globalization while supporting economic, and vice versa. It's complicated. It's messy. But by dividing it into these three categories, I think we can approach it in a more sophisticated and holistic way. So always try to think about these three dimensions and what they mean and what the benefits and drawbacks of all of them are. What's fueling globalization? We've talked about this. Technological development, spread of capitalist marketplaces, mass migration of people, new forms of media, all these things are important. In the opening parts of this lecture, we talked about some of the key ideas and concepts sociologists have come up with to describe the impacts of globalization. It might be this idea of liquidity, the idea of increasing network nature of society, more risk, the emergence of global cities, so many ideas we've discussed today. Again, don't try to memorize and think about every single one of them. Just go through them and try to get yourself a sense of the broad way that sociologists have thought about these changes. Finally, my last part was really about globalization and politics. I've said that globalization has become a key part of political debate. So much of our politics today revolves around what we think about globalization and what we want out of globalization, or perhaps what we don't want out of globalization. I think sociologists play a key role in contributing to this social debate by helping to clarify for us what the consequences of globalization are. Is globalization having positive or detrimental effects? Sociologists can add to that discussion by providing us with data, theories, and so on. Okay, and I hope that you'll think through some of the things we've talked about in this lecture, and again, think for yourself what your stance is on some of these processes of global change. All right, that's all from me. This is my last lecture for the subject. I hope you've enjoyed the content today. I will see some of you in the tutorials. If not, good luck for the rest of the semester.